IVM.
This is Storytellers and Storysellers live on tape. You're listening to Vineet Kanabar on the IVM Podcast Network. Before I started the recording, today's guest asked me a very interesting question. He was like, who's the audience for this podcast? Who's this really for? And so I can tailor my answers to that audience with that profile in mind. And my answer to my guest's question was the name of his company. I was like, my audience is under 25. And joining us today on this call is Anto Philip from Under 25. Anto, super excited to have you on this call. Super excited because the name of your company and a massive, elusive generation of young Indians, something that we need demystified for us is there for us to talk about. So welcome to Storytellers and Storysellers. Anto, how are you doing?
Yay! It's the moment. It's the moment. It's happened. I'm here, and I think it's come to a moment when my organization can be the category of the audience that you want to talk to. That's it. This is it. My life is made, and I don't need anything more. And that's it. That's my podcast time. That's it. I'm leaving.
All right, guys.
But yeah, thank you so much, show. Vineet. Looking
forward. That's now the last episode of Storytellers as well. I think we've all made it. We both made it. Moving on with life. I'm joking, obviously.
I'm so glad that you will stretch the joke and take it to the next level. We're going to have a great podcast.
Yeah, of course. I think 60% of all my podcasts are just like voices of people laughing or groaning at my ability to do this. But wonderful to have you, man. I've been following Under 25's work for a long, long time. You guys have gone from strength to strength. Started out as a sort of an event that brought together voices under 25, and now you're a multimedia company, if I may put it like that, doing cool shit on Instagram, pulling together content, representing the voice of the under 25. Tell us about the company, man. Tell us a little bit about the people there, how you think. Give us a whirlwind intro to under 25.
Oh my God, you said whirlwind intro.
I'm sure there's like a lot to say, right?
Yeah, there's a lot to say. So, So let me quickly give context, right? So here's how I'd like to start. It's a very overwhelming question for me every time because I'm always a work in progress with that answer. And the reason why I say I'm a work in progress with that answer is because I took on the challenge of trying to build a generation where the generation was truly, truly different every second of their living, waking life. And there is so much difference and change that happens to this generation on a day-to-day basis because of many factors. I mean, I'm not talking about the positive and the negative sides. I'm saying that there are changes. Let's eventually describe what is positive and negative. But today I know for certain that those changes are so native to our generation. And there is a certain sense of awareness that it's created in people. Mm-hmm. I think a huge part of my responsibility is to take that awareness and create something valuable and impactful out of it. So I believe that we are in a very, you know, transcending phase of our life where I think student population is going to have a lot more strength in the coming few years, not just in terms of their voice, in terms of the collective power that they have, but also in terms of the kind of clarity or the access to information versus how that information is being, you know, interpreted, right, is only evolving. As much as I'd say internet can take a lot of our available awake time, some people are starting to realize the power of it being used the right way. And I think the more and more young people see that, we are very competitive, right? We're born in a deprived economy and we want to get ahead. And I think that is one thing that is very common everywhere. But one thing that we forgot in that process is to celebrate that confusion of being young. And if I have to put Under 25 in one line, Under 25 dreams to celebrate confusion among young people because we're not defined by one identity. We are not defined by one style. We are not defined by one thought. We're a bunch of confused people trying to figure out how and what to make of life. And to embrace that is the first step towards clarity as opposed to you know, just going backwards and saying, hey, this is the rule book. Let me apply a few more formulas to my life. So very dreamy an answer, but to be very honest, that's how big the dream and the vision is of Under 25. But I often get caught in multiple conversations talking about how, what does the name truly mean? To me, actually, the name truly means that it's an emotion. It's a feeling. It's not the age. To be young is a certain kind of a mindset, and that mm-hmm. mindset is what we want to build the culture around, while keeping at the core the people who own that mindset, which is young people. But of course, it evolves into more people recognizing and accepting the power of being an irrational optimist, but also being very aware that the irrational parts of your optimism can turn into rational moments only if you put the effort towards it. So brilliant. That's Under 25 in a whirlwind.
Well done, man. Well done. Those were some very loaded but very meaningful phrases, turns of phrases there, right? I'll pick them apart in a second. But I love the way you said celebrate the confusion, right? Because I remember being 19, 20 and going to engineering college, you know, and doing decently all right as well. But nahi pata tha kya karna hai. Till I was about, I would say, about 26, 27, I was like, theek hai, now I know what I need to do. The last 7, 8 years, now I know exactly what I want to do in life, etc. But Under 25, it's a hard place to be, especially in a world that throws up so many options, so much glitz and glamour, that it's often hard to forget. It's often easy to forget that, bro, doing all of this requires application and effort, and the grind doesn't change, right? You might be confused about what you want to do, but the thing that is common between all you want to do is the grind, right? You may want to be an astronaut, or you may want to be an influencer, you may want to be a creator, or whatever you want to be, right? The grind doesn't change. And I love the fact that you ended by saying that your irrational optimism can turn into rational optimism based on the amount of effort that you're going to put into it, right? So I love it. From a vision statement, from a first question, answer of the first question, tick, full marks. I'm going to ask you a couple of things about how...
this is how the part where those audience just, yay! Yeah.
if this was a live, then you would have like hearts all over the screen right now, right? Like,
Shai is coming, Vineet. Don't do this to me like this.
No, this is just a beginning. Yes. But let me ask you this, right? And I mean, I read a piece about you that was put out in 2019 that talked about how you're an irrational optimist working for the youth. From that big, bold statement, right? Or from that vision, to bring it to life into real things, right? Whether it is doing first-of-a-kind things on Instagram, or whether it's your documentary going to film festivals, or it is just the fact that you do a Under 25 summit every year. How do you really bring it to life? Like, who works with you? How are you structured? How do you keep tabs on what the youth really cares about? How do you really do that within the org? And B, what's the team like? How is it working in an organization of young people? And I'm asking you this, and I'll contrast it for you, right? Organizations like this in the West either are incubated at a Berkeley, for example, or at a Harvard, right? Or they're a scam. Okay. Or it's just like,
you
oh, we're young
so
people.
Bang on.
Right? I mean, that's
you
been my
so
experience.
Bang on. Right? I can't even say how bang on you are. Yeah. Yeah, that's right? True.
But you're straddling the space between the two, and yet you're putting out stuff that really hits the mark, stuff that makes the news, stuff that makes audiences your age care about it, right? So help us, take us through the process at Under 25, right? Right from identifying something interesting and cool that you think the audience cares about to bringing it to life. How do you guys go to work?
You know, to be very honest, Vineet, I think the podcast is happening at a very right time. And also the reason why I say this is because the last 2 years have been very critical for the evolution of our journey. And I'll tell you that in parts while I'm answering this question, right?
Sure.
The question primarily asks me what entirely was the Under 25 game plan to execute this vision and how did you do it?
Right.
To be very honest, think about it this way. I'm going to start with a story. So think about, you know, this 18-year-old kid who's a middle-class Malayali boy sitting out of Bangalore. And I'm going through this, you know, sort of experience growing up, which have multiple different things that put me in places outside of the classroom. And I actively chose those moments. And the reason why I chose that is because what I saw at home, my mom was an absolute rock star. Dad was in the Gulf. Mom was here. Mom really took care of me and my sister and sort of ended up doing things. She really, if I had to say, I could see a person really embrace the world of co-curricular. And if my mom's job was the job, she was so good at the co-curriculars of her life that I could see her do so much more than the identity that she had to be, right? Which is a nurse or a mom. And I think when I saw that, it truly moved me. And upbringing plays a very big role in the kind of person that you are. And I started by saying that because that's what's wired in me as a person, to sort of really go out there and know that, you know, anything is possible. My mom's a very street smart person, while my dad is a very academic. He has a PhD. He always wants to teach. He's one of the smartest people I know, but he's also really, really smart. That there are times that my mom, me and my sister really intimidate and be like, whoa, like that's just like insane. How do you know so much? But it is what it is. And I think, you know, when I get to grow up in that kind of an environment, I really embrace my life outside of the classroom. And what it really did to me is there are two misconceptions that sort of come along this journey. One is, if you do a lot of things outside of the classroom, it makes you seem like you're a person who doesn't enjoy curriculum or learning, right, or vice versa. You are, you know, doing that well, so you're not going to do much of what's happening outside of the classroom. But the good
mix, I just want to stop you. I want to stop you and tell you that you're describing me, but I'm just going to let you continue.
Oh my God, that's crazy.
No, I did the same things, man. Same thing. Like outside classroom doesn't mean I don't enjoy studies, but exam mein marks nahi chahiye. I want to like experience the world, I think. That was the idea.
Exactly. I want to figure things out, right? And I credit a lot of my life. I only learned to realize this now because I learned the concept of reflection. While I was younger, I didn't know this. But while I now reflect and have the vocabulary to say these things, I'd say that sport played a very important role. Life outside of the classroom played a very important role. I always embraced opportunities that was a lot more than just the marks card or the score sheet. And the reason that happened was because culturally, I was a kid who liked, you know, going on stage, performing, being in skits, doing theater. And that sort of brought me to life, right? It sort of really gave me the drive that I had and the hunger that I had to do something. I also started, you know, leading in very small ways when I was very, very young, because I used to always end up being like the leader of the team or like a captain or, you know, building something for school. And that sort of led into the sort of kind of journey that I envisioned, right? It's to say that I just don't want to be another person graduating from a school. I want to do something that is much more than that, because everyone from my school is going to graduate from my school. So that's like regular now. So what do I want to do so that I can do something different and I want to try something new? That, you know, long story short, that drive sort of got me to sort of realize that the power really lies in embracing that reality as early as you can. The faster you realize that you have the power in you to embrace that reality and start working towards your dream. The thing that I, you know, coined yesterday, and I was telling one of my friends, I said, you know, it's very important that young people start realizing, and including me, start realizing that work towards your affordable reality immediately, so that it's not just a dream. You are getting, you know, closer to that dream by making an affordable reality that you have today work towards that dream. And I think many people forget that you can afford your reality today and do whatever you can towards that dream today in your current present. Don't wait for that dream to fully fortify and only then take that dream forward, right? So it takes really long for something you want in life to sort of materialize. And start early. It is the biggest superpower we have, because we have time, and students have so much time. Now, nowadays, not so much because we're spending it on many other things. But if you are aware of the person that you are, if you like doing what you're doing, if you like going outside and getting those claps and performing on stage and debating in schools and taking part in things that are much more than yourself, then you clearly have it in you, and make the most of your time, because, you know, you're special. And there are so many special kids in our country. It's unbelievable. That is my reason to take this vision forward. And we broke it down to very interesting steps. The reason why I said this story is because when we started Under 25, all of these were just stories and dreams. I could still go and say these things, but barely anybody would believe it because they'd all say, hey, this is another fancy young kid trying to do fancy young thing. I mean, I was anything but fancy and we were trying to do anything fancy. We were really trying to represent the life of a student outside of the classroom by taking them seriously, not for their academic achievements, but for the person that they are. Mm-hmm. And as early as you can spot and find that talent and foster it, you've built a generation in the process of doing that. So we then broke down that process into multiple, you know, steps.
Right. Let me ask you this very quickly though. It's something that I have also faced in life a lot. When you're trying to do stuff that's extracurricular in quotes or stuff that takes time away from focusing on your academics and stuff like that. Also, it's something that happens when, as a young person, you come up with something big or an interesting idea that seems implausible sometimes. But there is an inherent discounting that happens for young people. Right? Aray, ye chota hai, 20 ki baat. Bol raha hai, he's saying something. He doesn't know what he's talking about. Doesn't have experience. Yeah. So whatever. This casually manifests itself in 100 ways. It formally manifests itself when you're applying for a job and they want you to have 15 years of work experience for a social media job, for example. What was your method or what do you prescribe to young people when they are faced with this kind of a rejection that's maybe not based on their capability? Merit is a bad word these days, so I'm not going to use it. But yeah, it's just a prejudice almost against young people having big ideas and people like, bro, karte hai baad mein, something else. How have you dealt with this and how would you prescribe others to be?
Perfect. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to answer this and then I'm going to quickly jump into telling how we executed this vision. Because
we have to talk about that. Yes, I know you've been ignoring my question, but we have to talk about that.
Here's the part about rejection, right? So the way I treat rejection, and I'd request for every person listening to this to treat rejection, is one thing that I, you know, saw growing up, and I remember watching this video that really moved me. It was called 100 Days of Rejection. And 100 Days of Rejection was basically one guy who said that the biggest problem that he had in life about doing anything was the fear of being rejected. Because that feeling just takes away from the person that he was, and he just wouldn't want to get rejected. And the feeling of being rejected just sort of really takes him off guard. So what he ends up doing is he gets on a challenge to say, I'm gonna ask the most bizarre things to people around me, and I wanna get rejected 100 times. So that I can feel okay about being rejected. So I'm not going to do things because of the feeling of rejection, because I can overcome it, and let me get rejected 100 times. So the dude walks out and he goes to the day one, and this is so exciting. He walks out of his house and he goes to the, I think it was a security guard in his apartment building. And he says, I want you to give me $100. And the guy goes, no, I'm not giving you $100. Why would you want that? And then he freaked out because he got rejected and he ran away. And then he did day two, where he went and asked, I think day six, eventually went and asked somebody at Krispy Kreme to make him a donut, which looked like the Olympics logo. I mean, put multiple donuts together that looks like the Olympics logo.
Right.
And to his surprise, he gave context about why he was asking that. And then it so happened that she came back and she said, I couldn't reject, I couldn't refuse. So here you go. This is the rings of Olympic rings right in front of you, made by Krispy Kreme. So it goes on to show that, you know, the earlier you start understanding that rejection is a part of life, it is part of the story that you're living, start embracing it, start accepting it as early as you can so that you can get past it and be on the other side where, you know, there is a lot more to life than just, you know, facing rejections.
That's fantastic, man. I mean, I'm sure you have heard this a million times, but you have a very smart head on your shoulders. And that was a wonderful example to talk about how to deal with rejection. And that's just, I think, something that all young people can learn from, right? Because rejection often stems from somebody else's fear of the unknown, somebody else's not being able to visualize what you might be able to visualize. So having conviction in your own ability, your own ideas, your own thoughts, your own efforts versus somebody else's opinion of it, I think you've very clearly articulated what you should have faith in. Now, we will go back to the question that you've been ignoring.
Yes. Which is,
I have been ignoring this question. So I am going to answer. So here you go.
Let me tee it up for you again.
Yes.
Oh, sure. Cool. Like, you can, this is your podcast as much as it is. Please go for it.
On it. So let me quickly tell you what the under 25 game plan is, right? To be very, very honest, I've never publicly spoken about this before. If you look at us on the internet, we're very not so much vocabulary about us is out there because it's done for two reasons. One is done on purpose. Two, it's because it's always evolving. I don't think I can put out something and stay true to it for more than 1 year. So we have to keep evolving. So I think that's the reason why it is the way it is. So I'm going to quickly tell you what the under 25 game plan is from a point of view of the company structure. So our vision is to say that under 25 is not a festival. It's not a, you know, it's not a page. It's not a media brand. It's not a, there are multiple things that we can put to it as identities or categories. But what under 25 is, it's the universe, right? So under 25 is a universe. It's a universe of products that revolve around everything that a student would require in their life. So our ultimate focus, the center of the universe, is a student. And the reason why I call them a student, there are two kinds of students. There is a student who wants to learn, or somebody who's academically a student. And then there is a student for life, somebody who's curious for life, somebody who wants to keep learning and keep building or, you know, sort of exercising that curiosity in their mind. Which is why we say under 25 is not the age, it's the emotion. When you're young, when you're a student, there is so much that goes on and that can carry on in the rest of your life. For most part, some of the big reasons why I get to sit in some big board meetings and talk to some really incredible top-level C-suite executives is because they get to say that, hey, Anto, we'd require a perspective of a young person. Right. And we'd love for you to be there and tell us that. And I think, finally, there is agency to this generation. There is some voice. And we did it through products. And we said, we will build products. And every single product is going to be a part of the lifestyle of a person or a culture of a person who wants to be a youngster who just doesn't want to be defined by a marks card, or a youngster who just doesn't, is not represented by a certificate. I feel this generation is a many me generation, which is me included. I am a musician, a podcaster, a content creator, an entrepreneur, a scientist, and I swipe right on Tinder at the same time, right? It is, it's an entire vast array of, you know, things that young people can do today. And the power of that is to embrace that. And hence, we are also technically a portfolio brand. We have many companies, and or rather many verticals under one company. And we house it under the Under 25 universe. And this includes Under 25 Live, for example, has about six IPs. Under 25 Summit is one. Under 25 Summit at Campus is another. We have student labs. We have the gaming league. We have a bunch of really cool IPs. Some of it are released. Some of it are yet to release. But it is built with the identity of understanding, or the requirement of understanding what the young people are interested towards and how we can build an angle of edutainment. We don't want to, you know, not be a brand that that invests in responsible progress, because it is our responsibility to build something that is valuable as opposed to something that's flat. So more often than not, why this doesn't exist in many parts of the world is because the student is not taken seriously. Right? It is the academic institution that either controls or has the agency, or the parent that has the agency. So literally the student is in between playing catch up to whatever the other two sides want, right? And it is not their version, or it's not their story to tell. Under 25 is changing that. In simple lines, what UGC is to a university, Under 25 is to a student in the real world, in the youth world of today. And by and large, Under 25 builds the lifestyle of for you to be that person, be that creative person, by taking up opportunities as early as you can. And we build the credibility so that everybody on the B2B world can take the youngster seriously, not a frivolous party animal who's not going to wake up tomorrow and do the task that you're assigning them to do. By that, we have 633 million young people. Imagine if, you know, 5% of this, of that number just turns into the kind of, you know, whirlwind impact makers that we we are currently seeing, if we can scale that impact to a lot more people, a lot more young people, I think we have a different country to live in. So we've done it with live media and tech. Media is what Under 25 Dictionary is all about. But we have a total of 110 pages right now, talking to about 19.7 million young people week on week. We're the largest millennial media network in the country. Our single focus is to, you know, sort of address every single subculture and hyperlocal culture element of a student in their life or of a young person in their life. So subculture would include music, dictionary, news, confessions, college stories, etc., etc., etc. So the list goes on. That's our subculture media network. And then we have our, you know, a list of our fellows. We call them the Space Warriors, Space Warrior Fellows. Mm-hmm. These fellows sort of run, you know, the Under 25 universe in their respective campuses. That is hyperlocal impact. So we've built a really scaled up impact model. We are currently in 110 cities, impacting over 500 touch points, which are the campuses that we are a part of, or the, you know, the campus culture that we are a part of. Apart from that, we do a lot of work to sort of make sure that the student gets opportunities. So we curate the fellowship like it is better than college. and we do whatever it takes to give the student what they deserve. And the third part is, within media, we created studios so that we can scale up their impact with better storytelling and premium storytelling. Under 25 Studios is a creative camp that prioritizes the netizens. We build content for a new generation of viewers. We build serious quality content for a new generation of viewers. It's the place where we get to go as wacky and crazy as possible. We have a bunch of really cool clients. The recent Epigamia campaign that you saw, Dig's World Spread, was fully done end to end by Under 25. Studios. We're a bunch of really crazy, maniac young people who believe that anything is possible, and hence we're a team of 40 people. I mean, 40 people on payroll and a team of 500 people, including our fellows. We do. We are growing to a team of 100 people by the end of this year. We have three offices, one in Bombay, one in Bangalore, one in, we're just setting up our New York office. Our aim is to connect the students of the world. So we will take every step possible to make that happen. And tech plays a very critical role, because we want to consolidate all of our offerings into something that sort of really creates tremendous value for this generation. So that's where we are heading towards. And that's what the strategy, you know, sort of overall looks like. My bet is, in about a few years from now, we'll see a completely different India and of course, a completely different world, because the kind of potential that is going untapped because they are just a student is not worth it. Because I have seen 18-year-olds build better social media communities than 40-year-olds in this country, and I think it's time.
You would expect that, but it's wonderful, man. I think you should record that and use it as an intro to Under 25. This is just wonderful. I mean, the way you laid it out and the vision behind it and the renditions and the manifestations and the different platforms that you've created seems like you really got your shit figured out in that sense, in terms of what it's got, what it needs to do. It also, I mean, it might sound archaic for people. I might give away a little bit of my age as well. But to me, it feels like you've got a Gen Z Rotary International on your hand. Kind of. I mean, it might be reductive, might be a little archaic, but again, as a platform for enterprising young people wanting to do interesting new things, it sounds absolutely smashing. Let me ask you this, and you can answer as specifically or as vaguely as you like, but how do you make money?
Lovely. I love that question. It is. So full disclosure, of course, we're on our way to sort of really take our organization into a lot more scale. So here's what happens. We've built the organization in a way that we withstand two problems. One is, how do we withstand the age problem? That is number one. Number two is, how do we sustain this in the long term? Because culture and community in our country never pays.
Right.
And, you know, how do you sort of really solve for that, right? And these
unless,
are
unless you're an influencer, in which case everyone wants.
Yes. But you know,
you go to an event sponsorship and people are like, yes. Nahi, event sponsorship,
it's not gonna,
footfall kitna hai? People yes. are still asking footfall kitna hai?
Yes. And we're a long way to sort of really embrace that kind of culture of spending for things like this. And I don't blame any of us for that, because I'm equally on the blaming side. I don't pay either, because I come from a background that doesn't allow me to have that kind of spending power. So it is unfair for me to think the young people are suddenly going to start, you know, having money to sort of sustain the Under 25 vision. So the big dream for us was, Very simple. If you have to address these two questions, one, we have to sustain long enough and build trust. Build trust amongst our partners, our academic, you know, relations. We're not against the education institution or the education system ever. We're complementary to the system because if the student wants to be much more than what the college has to offer, the student is going to choose things, and we just want to sort of create some kind of a focus area so that that student can represent that quality with credibility. And today, recruiters all over the world, I mean, just look at the amount of student talent we have in this country, but it's almost always a mismatch of the recruiter finding the right kind of kid. And that's a huge problem we'll be solving, right? So what we did in terms of monetization was we built, you know, structures in every vertical that we created that can now enable the vision of what we call as Friends of Under 25. So we launched a program called Friends of Under 25, where top brands and top leaders and top visionaries of this country that think that young people are on a journey that is truly tremendous and believe that there is value that they can see as brands by engaging with our community. The single line for that is brands always want to engage with authentic communities, and authentic communities want to always work with brands that stand by that vision. Right. You need to sort of scale that. So we're a bootstrapped company up until now, and we monetized every single aspect of what we built. And we monetized it by, I often say that Shreyans is a Madhu, I'm a Malayali. One is thinking about saving money, one is thinking about making money. But to be very honest, we are not numbers guys. We didn't know anything about building a business or, I mean, we knew about leading teams, but we didn't know anything about numbers and financial models. But what we did was very, very simple. And I think that's what will help young people at large. We just figured out what it takes to get through the month.
Right.
And we did that every single month. And we kept doing that. So in a sports reference or a sports story, I want to say, it basically means that go to the court and play every day, you will become a better player.
Right.
And we just played every single aspect of what we wanted to play every day on the court. And we did it for 10 years now. I mean, it's 10 years since we first dreamt of Under 25 to where it is today. And I'm still young. And that's because I had the opportunity of starting that early and believing in this weird dream of ours. And that's what I say. Monetization happened over time. Now we have big clients who park big budgets with us for a year-long strategy of how they want to talk to young people all over the country. We take end-to-end strategy building projects that includes the entire Under 25 universe as an offering. We are able to talk to the new generation of viewers in a much better way than most people out there. I'm not saying we are the only ones who can solve all the internet problems, but we are the ones with maximum amount of access to this audience while giving you that solution. So that is how we have sustained our story so far. Of course, there is a lot more things in the pipeline, but slow and steady, and we've kept at it. We said, as long as you're consistent and as long as you play like yourself and you sustain the long tide, there are going to be days of rejection, but there are also going to be days of acceptance. And we just live for those days, and we made it this far.
Wonderful, man. I think I love the simplicity of what does it take to get to the end of the month and still be in the black?
Yeah.
Right? Just that simplicity. And I'm sure as you scale, as you grow, you have put in more powerful structures and you have a numbers guy in there who's telling you, nahi, itna paisa
too many. Too many numbers Now I can't execute an idea without giving a proper budgeting plan of how it's going to. I'm like, guys, come on. Like, this is not why we set up this team. I mean, this team was supposed to tell me, I will give you all the money to execute whatever you want to do. But that's not how reality is. I'm also on the other side sitting, why did you give somebody else money? So I'm equally the one to blame on both sides. But I think that's the joy of being an entrepreneur. It's the dichotomy of life.
No, there's no challenge in unlimited money being thrown at a problem, right? You have to work within your means. And as your company scales, I'm sure the fiscal discipline of using your money in the right way, making sure the things you pick up have the right kind of impact. As your brand becomes more valuable, you'll be more and more picky and choosy about how you do this. If you're going to do something, it's going to be like, hey, I'm going to put all my energy into this one thing while maybe last year we did those three things, but let's just do this one thing and let's just do it really well. Put all our energies and efforts there and make it really big and smashing. But I love it, man. I mean, there's so much clarity in terms of what you've built and where you guys are going. Let me just round this off to sort of the end segment. Let me ask you this, because we've talked about this segment, the Under 25 segment, so much. I want to get your cliff notes on this audience, right? A brand comes to you, they're like, bro, मेरे को इंस्टाग्राम पे लाइव चाहिए, लाइक्स चाहिए, और आई वांट टू एंगेज विद दिस यंग ऑडियंस, आई वांट टू डू समथिंग, राइट? वेयर डू यू बिगिन कंसल्टिंग देम, और वेयर डू यू बिगिन आंसरिंग दैट क्वेश्चन? टू सॉर्ट ऑफ रिफ्रेज माय क्वेश्चन, गिव अस योर लाइक शॉर्ट हैंड ऑन द इनसाइट्स ऑन दिस जनरेशन. व्हाट डू यू नीड टू डू एज अ ब्रांड टू बी एबल टू रिलेट टू देम इन अ वे दैट इज मीनिंगफुल, नॉट इन अ वे दैट इज अ मीडिया इंप्रेशन?
आई लव दैट क्वेश्चन. My fast brain wants to jump on a couple of answers, but I'm thinking, because there is something so beautiful about this question that I've tried to answer this, and I've taken this practice to try and, you know, answer a bunch of questions that would put me in a place that I know for a fact that I've been before and I didn't document that well. So I'm gonna tell you one of the versions of those answers that, you know, when I thought about this question, it was, and I have in no way, I'm in no way saying that this is the only way, but this is a way that I've seen work many times as a pattern. So this is my suggestion. So my suggestion is, more often than not, a brand, and I don't blame a brand, because a brand has commitments and big brands have bigger commitments. And when they engage with someone like an under 25, they, or rather anybody who's going to solve for their youth problems, they're engaging with a big commitment. They want to have the numbers and they want to have the scale, because the population is that massive. And it's also the primary internet audience. My mom and dad are not sharing things. I am sharing things. So that's the audience that they want to talk to. Now, what happens is, more often than not, we are taking the output very seriously and not taking the people who are doing that output very seriously. What happens is, we're treating them like marketing channels, not as community members.
Right.
And I think what happens is, in a country like ours and in a growth stage like this generation currently is in, it's a place where sniffing bullshit out, or I would say the best bullshit detectors in the world currently are young people. And also the people who feed into the bullshit are young people. So we're, you know, to blame on both sides. But I would say that, you know, being a little aware, you know for a fact that you're not going to make choices which are not authentic and real. Authenticity is a very loosely used word. I want to say that if brands are very clear about why they're providing value and how they are going to be a part of a person's life, not just for the money that they are going to provide, but for the impact, or rather the identity crisis that they are trying to solve for, young people want to be associated with you a lot more, because you're talking to them and you're addressing them like they're real human beings, and not just another piece of inventory that is going to give you X amount of sale. And to treat them like that, you need to change a bunch of things in your entire approach. It's to start taking young people very seriously. And it is so true that it is unbelievable how smart young people are, how smart the internet is. And to treat them like who they are in reality is what is important, as opposed to just treating them like a segment. And when you do that, you start ending up building a community, because you genuinely care. And when you build a genuine community, you're going to have people who stand by you. And hence, we call this internally, we help build opinion leadership. So we don't build influence, or we don't create a certain level of a sale metric. We create opinion leadership. They should believe in the opinion that you stand for, and thereby get connected to the identity, or get attached to the vision. So they're going to be a long-term, you know, sort of player, because today probably the young person does not have the money to spend on you. Mm-hmm. They're going to remember the things you did for them, and that is exactly why they are going to sustain with you in the long run.
Right.
So play long-term games with a generation that has a long way to go.
I mean, you answered my next question almost preemptively, because I was going to ask you a very marketing manager question, which is, how do I measure this? But I think you answered it in the previous one. And it is absolutely important to be playing the long-term game here, right? Because this audience has 40, 50 years of life ahead of them, of shaping the future. And if you treat them just like a view, or if you just treat them just like an impression somewhere, or इससे मेरा एंगेजमेंट आएगा, विदाउट ट्रूली अंडरस्टैंडिंग व्हाट दिस ऑडियंस केयर्स अबाउट, आई थिंक दैट वुड बी सेलिंग योर ओन बिजनेस ऑब्जेक्टिव्स इन योर ओन ब्रांड शॉर्ट. लेट मी आस्क यू दिस दो, राइट, एंड सॉर्ट ऑफ क्रिटिकल टू इवन माई अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ अ यंगर ऑडियंस, राइट? इट वॉज रियली इजी 20 ईयर्स अगो, टॉकिंग टू यंग पीपल वॉज MTV, दैट्स इट, राइट? MTV एंड you'd have local clubs or whatever, right? Where sports clubs, or you'd have youth clubs and stuff like that. But that was it, right? And today, It's a multivariate problem with multiple dimensions to figure out. It's not easy. I mean, I have sympathy for my brethren in the marketing community as well. It's not easy, right? I mean, sure, you'll say short video is what young audiences like, but there is no one young audience and there is no one type of short video, right? But there's a different type of community around each type of short video. I mean, you have young people educating other young people about financial choices in mutual funds using Reels. And who would have thought of that, right? While on the other side, you have young people from a completely different economic strata truly finding the time and space to express themselves for the first time because there was no space for these characters or these people or these audiences in our popular culture before short video and stuff like that came out. So what I want to ask you in my sort of long roundabout way is, where do you start with something like this? And is the attitude, hey, I'm going to try this also, that also, this also, that also, or is the attitude more classic research, right? Okay, I'm going to spend 3 months really going down, anthropologically understanding this audience, figuring out what works for them. What has worked for you? What kind of approach has worked for you? Is it like experiment, scale? Or is it, hey, I'm going to gather all this information first and then I'm going to do whatever I do is going to like hit the mark? What's worked for you?
I'm very tempted to give another answer. So I'm going to end with that answer.
Sure.
But so if I understand the question correctly, you're basically asking me, where does a brand start if they want to talk to this audience? Essentially, or anybody rather, if they want to address this strata of the society, what is the best way to do it?
Sure.
I mean, I love how you spoke about all of the tools that currently exist for one to interact with the young audience. To be very honest, it's a very vast, you know, country with many, many, many different places through which you can reach this audience. The one thing that I constantly keep telling to for one to start, you know, and for one to actually do something with this audience, please start by taking them seriously. I think that's the one thing that I always say. And I believe that I stand by it. And I'd request for whoever's working with this audience to take the audience, target audience very seriously, and specifically young people in this country, take them very seriously because it's unbelievable what they can do. And I've seen it firsthand. That's answer number one. Answer number two is work with someone like under 25 because of one reason. And this is not me trying to sell the brand, actually, you know, just honestly giving the logical reason. It's because I've spent 10 years and with a team of incredible young people just studying and going deeper and deeper into the daily needs for 10 years, right? Mm-hmm. And we've built patterns and we've built structures and we've built rituals and exercises that engage in so many different mediums, live media, tech, insights. There is a whole bunch of things that happens internally. I almost like to call us a lab that studies and elevates the audience and helps somebody who wants to talk to this audience, talk to them the best way possible by benefiting both sides. It sounds too much like it's a social enterprise, but I must say that the idea is to sort of really make the most of both sides. This side is really deprived of that kind of access, and this the brand side is always looking to talk to them. It's just that we've not been talking in the same language, and Under 25 is here with the vocabulary that can give this language to both sides. And I think that's the role we play. And hence, it's very critical to have a partner who has that kind of category depth and access and knowledge. And I'd like to promise that with the body of work that we've done, we've gotten really deep and far and sort of really kept the community at the core. So we will stay true to that. And for anybody who wants to eventually engage with this audience, we'd be a decent choice. And that's something that I know for a fact is very valuable in the long term.
Beautiful. I think you really saved the best for last year. before we round off this episode, let me do this. A couple of episodes ago, we happened upon a new segment of this show. And we're calling it Water with Vineet. So bear with me for a second. I'm going to ask you like quick short questions and you're going to give me answers. You know how this works, right?
Yes.
My first question to you is, give me three things that an under 25 generation finds inspiring.
Oh, I think the generation, I'd say more than what people feel inspiring, I'd say what people find cool and exciting is conversations that are more open and, you know, a lot more honesty. I think that our generation thinks that's very sexy and it's very cool. We are the first of its kind that has open conversations like this on the internet. I mean, it leads to both sides, I always say, but I'm so glad that the conversation is now being had and a lot more people are aware of the things that they need to be aware of, including equality. There's so many things that the internet is educating people. So that's number one. I think being honest and open with this audience is very sexy and we find it cool. Number two is, I believe that young people at large find anything that is not patronizing very sexy. It's I've grown into this. This might be a little personal, so sorry. But I think a huge part of everyone in the world is constantly telling that age is a factor to sort of have some kind of a difference in the way you do things. I just believe that experience is real and I believe in experience, but age is not equal to experience. I can be 10 years into this field and I can be experienced in this field, even though I'm still, you know, young. So I think that is number two. And I just, you know, I've had very honest and open conversations with anybody to say that, you know, please listen to yourself much more than you listen to anybody else, because at least at the end of the day, if it doesn't work out, at least you're glad that you made the choice and it wasn't somebody else's choice. So I think that is very important. And number three is, and this is my, I think my favorite is, I think young people find it very sexy when, or very cool when people all over the world, and this is, you know, not barring Indian audience, people all over the world come together to do something that is really impactful. You see a lot of creators, and I believe we follow a lot of creators who are out there to do something that is much more than themselves. And I feel like when you're young is when you need inspiration the most. You will see a lot more young people watching TED videos than older people. And that entire bracket of content consumption has now been shifted to a bunch of really smart people who are trying to educate in the most interesting storytelling formats through YouTube and, you know, for example, Vox Explained, et cetera, et cetera. I think it's really powerful when, you know, you're taught in a way that you understand that teaching the best. And I keep saying that we're digital natives. So I find anybody making the effort to talk to the digital natives the way they are is extremely inspiring and cool. I follow a bunch of them. I think Yes Theory is a great community like this. There are a bunch of really cool communities globally. Cool Man Coffee Dan, Artidote. So I believe that, you know, I find them inspiring because they are trying to create change in the way that they understand best. There are a lot of Indian creators like that. And I love all of them because without them, I don't think we can be inspired and we have the sort of, you know, what do you call it? The battery life to sort of get through the madness that being young is.
Wonderful. I'll recount that quickly. So you said the first one was open conversation, open and honest conversation.
Yes.
Second one was age is not equal to experience. And it is awesome when older people acknowledge that and treat younger people with the respect and the seriousness that they often deserve. And the third is packaging information and learning.
Yeah, storytelling.
Storytelling.
I mean, the best thing is storytelling for, I would call it, it is a story that is educational and edutainment is really inspirational. I think well-packaged edutainment is the way to go for this generation because I love seeing things, but I also love like the storytelling aspect of it with the design and the you know, the animation and the entire narrative. So I'm so glad that I get to live in a time that's the kind of content I get to consume. You're only as young as you are today, so make the most of it.
Wonderful. My second question in Water with Vineet is, what's the last book you read?
What's the last book I read? Oh my God, this is such a... In fact, I was reading this one book today. I didn't complete it, but I think it's a great book to suggest to everyone. It's called Trillion Dollar Coach. It's about the life of this coach who coached Steve Jobs and the founders of Google and coached like, I think, 120 people. At his funeral, there were 2,000 people saying, thank you, coach, because he'd impacted those many people's lives. His name is Bill Campbell. It's a great read for anybody anybody who likes leadership and the sort of
madness. This is the guy who has those Google Talks, right?
Yes.
The same guy who has those like amazing Google Talks.
Yes, yes. Bill Campbell is a legend. And so Eric Schmidt, who was the ex-CEO, along with two other friends, wrote this book. I stumbled upon it over the last couple of days. I'm moved. I'm a big believer in sport and coaches. So to see this and to see how a sports coach, he was a football coach and he eventually ended up becoming a great executive coach. And I believe that building great teams is the only way that you can build a legacy and sort of leave something that lives beyond you. And for anybody who has that kind of a dream, and it is not for everybody to go and build things and do. Sometimes you just want to, you know, sit back, relax. I go through crazy days every day, but I've chosen this life. So if you want to know more about how to manage teams and lead teams, Trillion Dollar Coach is a very, very interesting read. And please, please let me know if you read how you feel about it.
Fantastic. That's Trillion Dollar Coach by Eric Schmidt and a couple of other guys. My last question to you. Where do you see yourself in 10 years with under 25 or with under 25 and a bunch of companies? Where is Antrophilip 10 years down the line? 2031, when you're on episode number 50,000 of my podcast.
See, I can give a very, very like, oh, under 25, I'll do this kind of an answer, but...
I want a personal answer. Your investor deck answer. That's not what I want. I want a personal answer.
Yeah, yeah.
So be the change you want to be seen in the world, kind of. Yeah,
that's not cool. That's not exciting. So let me give you my actual like answer. Okay, if I had to tell this to my team, this is what I'd say. I'd say that I still want to wake up focusing on the fact that I need to tie my shoelace and get ready to get back into the court and make sure that I'm playing the best game that I ever played that day. That's exactly what I want to be doing 10 years from now as well.
Wonderful. Very Cristiano Ronaldo. Wonderful. Wonderful.
And that's it. I mean, whatever game that is, can I be fully present and can I be fully there? You know, they say it's a great quote. Sometimes it takes a long time for you to realize how to play like yourself. I'm glad that I get to play like myself and be my full self. And hence, I just want to continue doing that with full energy and full stamina and full health. Even 10 years from now, to get back into the court and play every day and make it count. Add to the board.
Fantastic, man. And all the best to you and to Under 25. For making all of that happen. Like I said earlier in the episode, you have a great head on your shoulders. I'm sure you get that all the time. And I'm glad that there are people like you and companies like Under 25 that are in and around with the right attitude, the right approach to young people, giving them a platform. I wish there were companies like this around when I was younger. I wouldn't have to do a lot of the things the hard way, I'd say. I mean, maybe I would have, but...
You killed
it. Knowing me, I wouldn't.
You killed it. Yes.
But yeah, I mean, the sentiment has reached, right? Then that's fine. Yes. Thanks so much, man, for taking time out and talking to us about this. I hope you had fun.
I'm smiling end to end. You can see that. And the reason I'm smiling is because, one, I'm so glad that I didn't do a lot of conversations over the last 40 days because I spent time sort of really building the internal architecture and just, you know, helping build for scale. Mm-hmm. And I decided that I'd avoid talking because it's so much that you're constantly exchanging immediate information. It's not clear. It's not well thought out. So when this happened, it was right about the time. And I said, oh my God, I'm super excited because it's happening at the right time. And that's why I'm able to say so many of the things that I said today is because of the kind of homework that I've been doing. And that's one thing that I want to give as a gift to everybody. We were made fun of and told that it's a negative thing to do homework, but nobody ever told us it's the biggest superpower you have because curiosity is the only thing that can get you far. And do homework every day because you can continue to be curious.
Absolutely. I'm a big fan of preparation. Big, big fan. If someone would have told me that at 16, I would have probably been a slightly better version of myself, but by the time I found out that preparation is the key and your mercurial talent, it may be great for one day out of three, but if you want to knock it out of the park three out of three times, you prepare and you prepare like hell.
I have a great quote for that. Live life by design and not by default. And I think that is so powerful and changed my life. In my daily calendar, I've written it there. I say, live life by design, not by default. Resistance can kill you. Get past it because there is so much about you that you still don't know.
Honestly, wonderful. It's so much wisdom coming. I'm just going to re-listen to this episode and regret about my youth for a second.
Okay. Or just give me all the money that you have and then I'll just go to like LA and just peace out and be like this cool influencer who's going to do influencer kind of things and change the world. That's what I'm talking about. That was not a dig. Okay. That was just being me. Right, that's my guilty pleasure. I want to do that. Come on.
I think it's a great dream to have. It's a absolutely a great dream to have. I have it. It's a dream I will never work towards, but I have it.
Yes. See, it's too cool. I mean, there is so much. I was a creator for a while. Oh my God. It takes the life out of you. And hats off to all the creators who do that with purpose and intent. It's love you.
Absolutely. You have to have everything from great creative chops. You need to know how to work with a team. You need to
work with brands,
skin.
Create pitches.
So much thick skin.
Ideate, talk to your community, address the audience, know what to say, what not to say. It is a life of its own. And boy, do we have some incredible talent.
There's no off days, right? There's no off day that you can be like, oh, now I'm in a safe space and now I can say what the hell I want.
Out. Yeah.
Anyway, wonderful talking to you, Andrew. All the best to you and Under 25. This is me, Vineet Kanapa, saying goodbye.
And this is me, Andrew Phillips, signing off.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'd like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, SEAT, CRED, and Global Victoria. We thank you so much for making all of this possible. So this week on Cyrus Says, Tapsee Pannu was recently featured in the Netflix original Haseen Dilruba was on. They discussed her experiences in Bollywood and a whole lot more. On Begin the Journey, Ashish Vidyarthi enlightens us with his wisdom on how one can get freedom from their own thoughts or insecurities when they communicate with others. On The Millennial Athlete, Tanvi and Shlok fill us in on all the drama from the world of sports with Wimbledon, Euros and World Test cricket making headlines every day. On Postcards from Nowhere, Utsav Memoria kicks off a new series, Beneath the Veneer. We travel to the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan where he takes us through his first experience of encountering the Red Sea. We have a brand new show, Misconduct. It's a true crime show hosted by Raghvi, a lawyer, and Nisha, a PR pro. They tell us about the story of Cyanide Malika, the lady who offered cyanide-laden sweets to women and after they die, loot their gold. On the Global Victoria Tech Talks podcast, we showcase some compelling new tech stories coming out of Melbourne. On one episode, Pawan Srinath speaks to Joe Agan from Nelnet International, where they discuss how the pandemic has affected the edtech sector and its evolution. Another episode has Varun Dugirala talking to Ross Simons from Big N Studios about the gaming ecosystem and how they envision translating a sport to a game. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Working Monday to Friday, glued to your chair, making you feel dull? Worry not. Get your 5-minute weekly dose of travel around the world with Postcards from Nowhere. Join me every Thursday as I explore the strange, obscure, and fascinating parts of the world and bring out facets of travel you may not have thought of before. You can find us on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you get your podcast from.